Today we're going to be sound designing for the Sounds Vault at BusyWorksBeats.com. It's basically going to be a huge vault of sounds. I'm going to update it every single month or week. And basically you just pay one price and get access for the entire year. So that's a project I'm working on. It's called the Sounds Vault. Okay, so one thing about my company, we've been focused on training, which is amazing. Now the training has expanded. It's time to give you guys the tools to use. So not only do we have the plugin Narcos at BusyWorksBeats.com/Narcos with, I think, 280 sounds, if I'm not mistaken. And we also already have, you know, what is it, 70-something courses if you go to BusyWorksBeats.com/premium. But now what I want to focus on is giving you more tools and more curated tools. So I've been working on what's called the Sounds Vault. And in short, for 2024, what it is you pay one price, you get access to everything in the vault for the entire year. This is not like, this production suite is coming out. You need to be on this special email list to get into this beta program, to get into this production. It's not going to be that corny and complicated. It's just going to be, you want in, we're going to be developing this project over time, and you're going to have access to it over time. So it's pretty simple. Alex is here. What up? Waxiest Ant, what's up? Apurilis, what's up? All right, so here's some of the sounds. Just to show you what I'm going to sound design today is melodic one-shots, melodic loops, and MIDI, drum loops, and MIDI, and then we'll see how much we got. So I have to create 10 of each, so I'm letting you guys kind of see behind the curtain in the process, because yesterday I found it very enlightening when I was sound designing. So here are some of the sounds so far. There's 808. I might have to crank this up. Let me see. So I sound designed all the stuff from scratch. Here's my favorite 808. Reminds me of spins, but just like on steroids. And when you sound design, you start to have favorites and everything else. Trinidad in here, Poland in here, what's up? You made a trap beat with your tutorial. There you go. Success. Small wins are going to add up. As long as you keep studying small things at a time, you'll be able to learn so fast. All right, so I sound designed hi-hats yesterday. Those are all from scratch. And we have kicks. Now, kicks are my favorite out this whole kit. Kicks, they punch so hard. Let me turn this up. Sometimes they turn it down. My bad. Let me do it again. Like, these kicks hit. They're not boring kicks. And I'm working on sound effects. I need to write that in actually. Sound effects. So still working on sound effects. And then snares was interesting too. Teaching arrangement methods would be great for live for another day. Arrangement. Thank you. I actually have the Better Beatmaker course where we're going to be teaching arrangement. So if you go to BusyWorksBeats.com/BetterBeatmaker, that's where I'm going to be teaching that type of stuff for producers. Okay, so we have snares. So you might be like, how do you get this type of snare? You know, maybe one day I'll show you the techniques, but that's a synthesized snare and it sounds so real. Okay. All right. So that's what I've sound designed so far for pack number one. I didn't give it a name yet. So now we're going to do melodic one shots. So since you guys are in the one shots, I'm going to show you how to take it up to level 15. Okay. Because my one shots are not going to just be simple one shots. I'm going to give you what are called multi-tracks. And with the multi-tracks, you can actually play it like a synth. So it's way better. Way better. Dreamulator, what's up? So first step is figuring out what type of tone are you going for. Are you going for a bright tone, a dark tone, padsy tone, a soft tone, a hard tone? So just deciding what are you trying to create will help. Now, if you're going organic sounds, you might want to start with, you know, organic libraries and process the sound in a very unique way. But we're not going to start with sounds that already exist. So let's open up Serum for now. And if we have to get complicated and specific, I'll pull up other plugins. What up, Dreamulator? All right, so give me a challenge in the chat. Let's start off with a challenge. You guys get to determine what type of one shot do you want to create. You can say any instrument. Now, keep in mind, organic instruments are going to be really hard to synthesize. So just be fair. You know, if you say saxophone, you know, we might have to skip that one. Funny enough, I typed an instrument and the first thing is saxophone. That's crazy. So let me know what instrument or sound type you want to create, and then I'll show you guys how to create it from scratch. So again, the goal of this live stream is not viewership. It's to show you what I'm actually doing behind the scenes. Because I haven't made long form content in a minute, so I want to show you guys what I'm up to. Yeah, I've done shorts. The shorts are doing really well. I want to thank you guys for supporting the shorts. Getting a ton of subscribers off those shorts. So I want to thank you guys. Andre3K's flute. All right, a flute. That's an interesting concept. So let's go to Serum. Let's load up some white noise. And let's do, let me see here. Let's do alpha noise. Okay, now you would think that a flute is a sine wave of some sort. But what we can do is use a special type of filter called a comb filter. And this comb filter, let me find it here. Comb filter. We're going to run the noise through it. And if you turn up the resonance and turn on key tracking. Synth? Yeah, a synth. Any synth, yeah, name it. Okay, so there's different comb types. And there you have the comb filter. So what a comb filter is doing is taking random noise and it's chiseling out specific harmonics to sound like, you know, it's just mapping out harmonics. Now, if you didn't know, in Serum, you can left click on this grid and you could actually see different types of filtering. Most people just like leave it on default. You could actually left click this to see the frequencies. So it's taking the white noise and it's reshaping it into the green. And now you have somewhat of a flute. You just got to add some legato. And pitch it down, probably an octave. So let's pull this down. And let's add some effects, like reverb. Still a little high pitched. I'd probably pitch it down even further. But that's how you create flutes. And now it's just a matter of shaping your cutoff. And for this sound, I'm going to add a compressor just to kind of tame the sound. You could use FM8, true, to create harmonics. Sorry, just got an ad. What did you ask us to do? Oh, okay, my bad. The challenge is just give me an instrument you want to create or a sound. Organic instruments are a little more difficult because they take a lot of time. Marty Manning is here. What up? Thank you for popping in. This is more so, this live stream is just a behind the curtains on how to sound design. Since I'm already sound designing, I've been taking a lot of time to do it. So I was like, why don't I just show you guys? And if anybody watching the replay, if you want to learn this stuff, I have a sound design course. You could join for free. Just go to busyworksbeats.com/premium. Making real sounding instruments on Serum's challenging without custom wavetables. Yeah, so that wasn't even with a wavetable. So that's your flute. Okay, so let's say you want to create one shots. Now, what most people would do is simply go in the top left of Serum, and there's this button here that allows you to export something. So just drag that and drop, so now you have a one shot. That's how most people do it, which is fine. You know, we could save this and say that it's a one shot, but the problem is when you go to map that across a keyboard, it's very, artifacts when you go to, can't talk today. You'll hear artifacts when you go to stretch the sample. So what I'm going to do is map this out to where we're playing multiple notes. I usually map this out to where we're playing octaves. Of course, somebody's doing like metal work right now outside. Okay, so what we're going to do is map out all the C notes. So we're going to do the lowest octave is usually C1 in FL for me because you can't really hear that tone at that point. So it's kind of arbitrary. Then we're going to do the next octave up, C2. Then we're going to do C3. I know Marty Manning has kits, so hopefully this is teaching you something or another. Now, we're not doing drums today. We're just doing melodic stuff. And then C4, and then C5, and then C6. It's probably the highest I'd go, okay? So once you have all those mapped out, what I usually do is I'll create a time marker. So let's hit Alt-T, call this C1. Now, in FL Studio, C1's actually not C1. It's actually +2, so that's like -1. FL's weird, okay? So you have the -2 from what it actually is. So C0 is actually C2. Don't ask me why, it's just FL is like that. Okay, so technically I could pull this up one octave and that would make more sense. Okay, so now that I have all those octaves, we're gonna move this, make sure I have everything. So this is C1, from, let me double check. Excuse me, C0. C0, you're like, why is this important? Because if you go to other DAWs, you know, they map out their MIDI differently. So we're gonna call this C1, C2. So I'm just adding time markers. The reason this is important, and this is how it's sound designed for my synth, by the way. So I'm not showing you guys something that I don't do. C5. Now that you have all these octaves, let me make sure this is actually C5. Yeah, it is. Okay. Then we're going to right click, consolidate from track start. And we need to make sure that save loop markers is actually on. And I'll show you why that's important. So let's render this flute. One thing I forgot to add was vibrato to the flute. So let me go back. Forgot to add one thing. So what we want to do is have the pitch wobble over time. Let's add this LFO over top the pitch. And let's go to the matrix here. We want this to be a left and right so that it's bipolar, it's called. And then we're gonna pull in the range here. This may or may not work. But we might have to use it over the cutoff. Let's try it over the cutoff, actually. Okay, so again, you have to go to the matrix to make it what's called bipolar so that it goes both ways. Pull this range in. See how it's very like... Okay, so let's just fix the time so it doesn't sound so crazy. And then let's add what's called a delay so it doesn't just vibrato right off the rip. It's kind of difficult because the range is so sensitive to that one is a pretty big pitch range. But that's pretty good. Okay, so let's do this one more time. So what we're doing right now is rendering this flute to audio so that we can program this and chop up the samples. What's up, Novo? And then we can load it up into DirectWave. So I'm showing you the entire process. Let's do this one more time. So we're taking MIDI that strikes each octave of C. So we're not just making one shot. We're making 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 shots. Okay, and then we're gonna take those 6 shots and spread them across the keyboard so that people can play it like an instrument. And that's the difference in my sound packs, okay, that I'm gonna be putting out. It's not just one sample. Okay, so let's right click, consolidate track from track start. Make sure save loop markers is on. All right, so now we can double click in here and now we have the loop markers. Why is that important? If you right click, edit in audio editor, in Edison, it will map out the different samples. I'm gonna answer your question in a second. We're gonna right click, delete the loop. And you see all these markers, C0, C1, C2, et cetera, et cetera. So what we're gonna do here is go to the top left and we're going to export regions and then for sampler use. Okay, so now we're gonna go to our desktop, find our folder. Let's call this, well, it's gonna be in packs. Let's call it packs. Let's create a new folder called one shots. And let's create another folder called flute. Call this flute. Okay, save that. So now it renders each of these samples into that folder. Novo says, do you have any tips for me? I've started producing yesterday and getting mental breakdowns because I want it to sound professional. I think we all get excited when we first start learning. But that's actually, you got to be careful because if you take on too much, you'll actually discourage yourself. It sounds boring, but if you take on just 1 to 2 hours every night, I did this with learning coding. The way I learned coding, Python coding, I took 1 to 2 hours every night. I studied one new concept or two new concepts. I did not overly study. I studied one new concept every night. And, you know, I had a structured format. It was called Codecademy. So this is why my website is so important, is because if you go to busyworksbeats.com/premium, I guide you step by step so that the next step, you know, goes back off the last step and it all makes sense moving forward. And you have to have a teacher that does that, because if you learn random tips, you're not going to understand where you're going. There's no step-by-step process. So if you learn one concept, one new concept, I'll say, okay, and 1 to 2 hours every night, and then make sure that you actually apply the concept, then you will learn faster in 30 days than you've ever learned anything, probably in your life. I did that with Python coding. I knew nothing about coding. Went from not even knowing what to put in the document to 30 days later writing 200 lines of code, and I knew nothing about coding. So you have to approach it the right way. Don't take on too much. Now, most people think, here's a little caveat. Most people are like, Game, why don't you make these hard beats every single video? One, it takes way too much time to make hard beats. You guys know how long it takes to make beats sometimes. So am I going to do that every video? We have 5,000 videos. it doesn't make sense to do that for every single video. And plus, when I was learning coding, I wasn't learning from Facebook code. I was learning basic code, and now I understand the basic concepts. If I learned how to code by deconstructing Facebook code, it would just make me more confused. So I think what happens is people go into way more difficulty than they're ready for. And that's why they get discouraged. It's like going to the gym and trying to bench press 500 pounds without ever practicing. That's insanity. And so you have to just go step by step. It's actually more fun that way too. Okay, so now that we have the one shots folder, we have the flute. You'll see that all these samples are loaded up. Okay, so what can we do with these samples? We can load up what's called direct wave. Okay, so this is how I'm converting my one shots into playable instruments. Print hello world, right? So in direct wave, we can just drag and drop the samples from this folder. So I'm going to highlight these, drag and drop into this window right here, and it will auto map the samples for me and stretch them across the keyboard. So anything above C5, it basically is going to time stretch. Okay, so it doesn't matter because you get so high of a frequency, it doesn't really matter what it sounds like. Now the lower frequencies, you can play those. So now, you know, some things you could do. Let's load up some MIDI real quick. So for those who are kind of lost in what I'm doing right now, I'm showing you how to take one shots to a whole different level. And I'm doing this with my own products. So this is something that I don't really teach people at all. But, you know, there's only going to be a few people who implement this anyway. Should you buy Omnisphere? If you have to ask, no. It's not something where it's going to change your life like that. If you have to ask. Now, if you were just like curious and you bought it, that'd be different. But if you have to ask if you have to buy it, don't. I mean, I'm not going to say don't buy it, but I'm not going to say you shouldn't be asking should you buy Omnisphere. If you're going to buy Omnisphere, if that makes sense. Like if you're going to buy Omnisphere, you're just going to do it. Okay, so here's what the MIDI sounds like. Okay, so that's super high pitched. Now you can go in and add more delay and reverb onto the actual sound. Let's turn on reverb. Pretty high pitched, just off the default. That was a high pitched sound. Okay, so we can save this now. We can go to the top left, save, I believe, save preset. I always forget which one to save. Or is it this button here? Let's do that. Actually, no, I'm wrong. Click this folder, and we're going to, I haven't done this in a minute, so I'm trying to remember. Create program and save it as, yes, I think that's it. And then we're going to save this as a direct wave instrument. So let's go to our sounds vault. And now we're going to type in a folder called direct wave instruments, kind of like contact instruments, but for FL Studio. We're going to call this one flute. What's up, Ozzy? And everybody else who I didn't say what's up to. Dawn Walker's here. What up? Igor. Riley's here. Skidda. Tyrone is in the building. What up? Oh, yeah. Happy holidays. I completely forgot to say happy post-Christmas. Those who celebrate it. Glow is here. All right, so let's save that as flute. So now if I go back to that folder, I should be able to load it straight up. So let's just see. Direct wave, flute. And it includes the samples in a subfolder. Okay, so let's right click, open that up. And then this will allow people to play your samples as actual instruments inside of FL Studio. Now I probably should have pitched my samples down 2 more octaves. But that's how I just turned a one shot into a full instrument. Okay, so hopefully you're grasping how this is not just, you know, a one shot. Okay, so that was a flute. You guys get to pick the next instrument. What else do you want to sound design here? Somebody said synth. What kind of synth? There's a lot of synths out there. Let's see. FM8. You want to use FM8 to sound design? So I'll let you guys pick a sound. And again, if you pick organic sounds, it's going to be a little more complicated. So try to pick synthetic sounds if you can, or like categories of sounds. So pick a sound. What category do you guys want to make? And again, for those who are watching the replay, the goal of this live stream is to just let you know what I'm doing behind the scenes. It's not like to get a million people in here. It's to show you what I'm doing. Again, if you didn't get the news, we're creating what's called a sounds vault for 2024. Basically, it's going to be one price. You get access to the entire sound vault for the entire year. It's probably going to be multi-year. I haven't figured that part out. But the goal is just create a mega resource and not make it so cheesy and markety. Like, here's a production suite. Here's the beta to get into the production suite. And then this production suite has a secret samples over here. I just feel like that's, it might be fun for some people, but I mean, it just seems kind of overly done. So I'm going to make one big vault full of a lot of sounds until our sound library becomes just impeccable. And then I want to work into plugins eventually. Bells, okay. Oh, lead sound. Okay, so let's do lead, bells. I'll write this down. Lead, bell, horns. We'll do synthetic horns because I don't have real horns on. All right, so let's start with those. When I buy your courses, are there step-by-step tutorials for beginners? And what does it say? And while? Oh, and which categories of beats are there? So yeah, we have beginner's courses for FL Studio. We have beginner's courses for music theory and mixing. So those are your basic categories. FL Studio beginner, you have mixing beginner, and then you have music theory, which is going to be your most impactful one, music theory. So all that is, yeah, just go to the link at the top. It's actually busyworksbeats.com/premium. You actually get a free trial. So even if you don't think it's beginner, you could always cancel at any time. So it's just to let you see what's behind the curtain. Synth guitar. Okay. Synth guitar. Excuse me. All right, let's do these one by one. So lead sound, let's move a little bit quicker here now that you understand my process. Now, a lead sound is usually a sound that has what's called legato or monophonic properties. Pads, thank you. Okay, so we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sounds to make. All right, thank you. Okay, so a lead sound usually has what's called like a monophonic property, which means you can slur the pitch like that. Keys, okay, we got a nice little list going. Sorry, my pen sucks. I forgot my pencil upstairs. Okay, so let's do this one by one. Okay, so a lead sound, let's start from scratch. The main thing about a lead is just that it has a legato and monophonic. Everything else about a lead can be different. You could have soft leads, hard leads, psychedelic type leads, slower leads, fast leads. Leads is a very wide category. The main thing that makes a lead though, is the legato. Like that versus just this. Okay, so that's not monophonic. Here's monophonic. And legato. So lead is just that. That's a lead. Everything else about the lead is up to what you do with the lead. So I'm trying to think of a lead that we can sample into a one shot that would sound cool. So I'm going to move fast here. Okay, so I'm using my own sound design technique too. So we're going to detune this. Pull in the detune. Okay, we're going to add some noise in here. Most people avoid noise, but I like adding noise to do strange things here. So it's almost like cement kind of fills out the sound. Now we're going to run those sounds through what's called a filter. And most people don't know in Serum, there's a multi-filter mode. So let's go to multi-filter mode, change out the morph. And we're going to have this morph knob move over time. So this is going to create a unique expression. Thank you, Nova. Let's go to matrix. So I want to be careful here. For beginners, this is way advanced. Like what I'm doing on the screen right now, not for beginners. This is for intermediate to advanced people. I just want to make that clear. I don't want beginners to like try to memorize what I'm doing. Or think that music production is about sound design. It's not. Okay, so now I'm moving this filter type. So it's tilting the energy of the lead so that it has a little more life to the sound. Feels like a moving thing. The biggest mistake I see with people in sound design is that they don't move their sounds. They keep them stagnant. Let's drag this LFO over top of the fine tune pitch. This is going to create vibrato. The 80s type of sound most people talk about. And I could have this set to a different, it's called takeoff BPM mode, and set it to a different rate. So we can do it slower, faster. I think here's a sweet spot right here. I'm gonna lower the noise a little bit. Okay, now also, you can load up custom noise. So I'm gonna load up some noise I imported into this folder. If you don't know how to import sounds into your folder, go to your menu. Go to, where is it at? Show Serum Presets folder. It should pull up your folder on your computer. What's up, Ozzy and Levente and King DJ Michi? What up? JM Beats is here. Patty P. Current is here. What's up? Svitoslav, what's up? Okay, so here and under the noise folder, just double click here and drag in your own folder called, I called mine user. And then I created another folder with Sound Oracle's textures that he had. So what I'll do to make this sound unique is take this noise and go to user folder, and then we're going to add in some vinyl noise. So I'm going to click here, and then I'm going to turn this up so I can hear it. I'm going to take the filter off for a second, and I'm going to turn oscillator off. So here's the vinyl noise. So you get different textures you can add over your sound. So like this one, let's add that in, and we're going to run that through the filter. But you can't tell it's there because I filtered it. So it's just like artifacts, basically. And now we add our sound in. Okay, so now we can move the cutoff. And what I'm going to do is, you know, create an envelope for the cutoff so that it feels more expressive. So let's drag envelope 2 and let's give it an attack. Now, where the pointer is where it will land, the ending point. Okay, so the pointer is where it ends when you release the note. So it starts, goes, and comes back. So this is how you add more of a brassy tone, basically. And you can turn up resonance so that we know the filter is moving. I know I'm really advanced here, but I'm just letting y'all know how much goes into sound design. Okay, so now let's add a little release here. Okay, so this sounds a little, it sounds cool, but it could be cooler. Okay, so let's start adding effects. And let's turn off oscillator B right now. To add some chorusing, and if you want the perception of room, add some dimension. We're going to turn off hyper mode. So now it feels like it's in a space. And nextly, if you're going for EDM sounds, go to multi-band mode under the compressor. I don't know why this was already so compressed, but let's pull this up. And now you can kind of smack the sound with this multi-band command. And redistribute the harmonic attenuation. I don't really like the compressor. Let's add one more thing. You could add a filter in your filter section. Let's add what's called a distorted comb filter. We're going to open this up, turn the drive up, and then mess with this comb filter frequency. Now you can have this modulate over time, but the way you would modulate this is you have to go to what's called the mod matrix, or you can right click, go to mod source. We're going to say LFO2. And now this will move over time. This is like a secondary detune, basically. And let's slow this down. Now we're creating what's called a flanger type. Okay, so now we're adding dimension and movement. Let's add oscillator B here. Now, the filter is kind of comb filter-esque, so I'm going to turn that off for a second. So let's just switch out the filter type. Something's moving too fast. I think it's this one. So it's still a little thin. Has a unique sound, but trying to decide. A little thin. Okay, so since the sound is a little thin, let's add a sub oscillator. Turn down that level. I usually use a sine wave because that's a fundamental frequency. We're not trying to introduce harmonic content. Okay, so it still feels thin. Let's figure out what's thinning the sound out. I think it's the chorus. Yeah, that chorus was thinning the sound out. Let's pull back this dimension. So now I'm just trying to thicken up the sound. It was a little too thin. Trying to figure out a filter that actually gives us a vibe, so give me a second. main goal here is just to not thin out the sound too much. I think let's try 4 minutes. If not, I'll just go back to simple low pass. Pretty cool, like a West Coast sound. So now we have that. Let's go back to pattern one. And then now we have to sample these sounds. What up, Sonic the Hedge, the Hemphog? Leica is here, Ryan is here, what's up? So again, I'm just showing you guys behind the scenes what I'm developing. It's called the Sounds Vault. I'm just letting you guys see behind the curtain. So if a sound still feels thin, what I'll do is I'll process the sound, because right now it just feels extra thin. So let's figure out why. Let's open up an EQ. My sweet spot is usually 75 hertz. Whenever a sound feels super thin in the bass, I'll boost 75. As you can see, there's not much 75 here. So what I'll do is we'll just cut out lows below 80 at 24 dB per octave. And then we need to figure out what in this sound actually sounds good. On the lows, I mean. And let's compress this. Let's use Arc Comp. Simple compressor. Where are we at? Arc Comp. So again, the goal is to just get it sounding full and up front. Then let's add NL2. Also, Kilohertz has pretty good stuff. Let me see something real quick. They have something called a reverser. I want to try it real quick. Nah. Oh, I clicked the wrong one. Reverser. Let's see what this sounds like. And let's see what this sounds like. Okay, I'm trying different increments. Okay, reverser doesn't sound too good on that one. All right, so last thing I'm gonna add an L2. We're not gonna experiment too much with the processes. Okay, so the goal is just get it loud. Okay, there we have it, too loud. So as you see, as we go higher in the octaves, it gets louder and louder. We need to watch. What's up, Seymour? Merry Christmas and Boxing Day. I got a beat for you. There you go. Yeah, we're still curating that artist. Haven't found any good artists yet. It's hard finding good artists. Because now these are maxed out. Okay, so now we have that. Let's right click, consolidate from track start. Well, who's boxing today? And I want to take off the master effects. We're going to save loop markers, print this. The sound could be better. I just don't want to spend too much time on it. Just double click in here. We're going to right click, edit an audio editor, delete the loop, save, export regions for sampler use. We're going to save it back into the folder under the Sounds Vault and save it back into our one shots and then call this lead. Now, in this case, you would call it the actual name of your sound. I'm just being vague, calling it lead. 9000 type beat. How 9000? Paleface, whatever. I like your loop. Save that. Okay, so now that we have it saved in that folder, we're going to load up Direct Wave. Direct Wave, where you at? Direct Wave. Let's go to our browser. I'm going to go to where it says lead, highlight all these samples, left click, drag them into Direct Wave. So now they are a playable instrument. You can add delay, reverb, whatever you want. So let me load up some MIDI. I think I have some MIDI saved. Let's copy, paste. So now let's hear what it sounds like as a playable instrument. How long have I been producing? Since I was 14, but seriously, since probably 8 years ago. Let's add some reverb. Okay, so once we have the effects, sound could be better. With vocal type stuff, it could be better. Let's go to the top left, save as under program. And let's go back to that folder we had called Direct Wave and our packs. So that lead could be better. When you sample leads, it's different than actually programming a preset. Sampling leads is a little bit different. All right, let's go here. And I should have saved that flute into its own folder. Okay, so now when you go and to double check all this, you just go back to that folder, hit your lead, right click, open a new channel. Now you should be able, anybody should be able to play what I just created in their DAW as long as they have FL Studio. So it's kind of like our version of Kontakt, but it's FL Studio based. So this allows people to sample their own sounds and let other people use them. So that's what I'll be doing in the Sounds Vault. And now you can play this just like an instrument. And the cool part is you can go into the settings here and make it monophonic. And we can turn polyphony to 1. So there's extra functionality you can get. And that's why I use the FL version instead of Kontakt. Kontakt, in order to do that, you would have to program in monophonic, and that takes so long to learn scripting. Boxing Day, because it's the day you return all the Christmas presents. You return all the Christmas presents. Oh, is that a UK thing? I didn't know that. Okay, so that's a lead. Okay, let's move on. So the lead could be better as far as like its purpose. Usually leads are really simple. They're sine waves, triangle waves, or solid waves. That's really it. And they use a low pass filter most of the time. And delay and reverb. I was just being exotic with that. If you purchase FL Studio Fruity Edition, do you keep it forever? And can I actually save my projects? Yeah, you can. I would recommend the Producer Edition though. Fruity Edition seems like a waste of money to me. All right, so let's move to bells. So bells are interesting because we can use what's called FM synthesis. Let me use a different plugin outside of Serum for this. You're on FL Mobile? Wow, you're a real risk taker. So people who mastered FL don't even mess with FL Mobile. So the fact that you've mastered it, or you know, trying to master it, good luck. Okay, let's go to what's called the Expert tab. Where are we at here? Let's go to the Expert tab. This is a little complicated to explain, but basically you can have an FM synthesizer have one sound modulate or control another sound. So let me just show you what it sounds like to modulate something. So here's what's called a sine wave or a fundamental frequency. I'm going to have it modulate itself, and it's going to create what's called upper harmonics. So basically I'm turning a sine wave into a saw wave the more harmonics I add. Yeah, I bought all these plugins, or they were given to me by the company. Now this took years and years and years and thousands of dollars. So hopefully I can save you time. So if you have plugins that you're looking at, Raphael, I could probably tell you if it's worth it or not. Okay, so we can have that modulation from other sources. So FM forces you to think about sound into parts. You have a transient, which is that clicky part of the sound. There's the body of the sound, which is the middle part, and then you have the tail. So you have to think about sound in three sections when you're designing through FM synthesis. And it creates a unique combination of sound. So with bell, I'm thinking, okay, you strike a bell with like a hammer, or you hit a bell with an impact. So you're going to have a very sharp transient. And then the body of the bell is going to be the tonal part. And then the tail end is going to be how long the reverb kind of lasts. So thinking about bells that way, we have, let's start here. So I'm going to have operator. These are called operators, not oscillators. What are some essential plugins to buy? That's too vague of a question. You got to ask me about a specific plugin. I have videos about the best plugins, but there's too many purposes and reasons why you would buy those plugins. It depends on what you're trying to do. Just ask me, do you think a good plugin's good for this? And I'll say yes or no. Having a real studio is not in the budget right now. Yeah, I mean, don't worry about a studio. All you guys truly need is a laptop and some headphones, some iPhone headphones. These are like $15. You do not need all this extra stuff that everybody's using. Trust me, I've spent many thousands of dollars to tell you that all you need is your laptop and your headphones. Some people don't even use the headphones. They use the laptop speakers. So don't overly spend where you don't need to. Literally, your laptop is going to be your biggest expense. Okay, so we have this E tone. We want E to modulate F. Okay, let's go to E. Now notice I'm not getting that sawtooth type sound, so I'm going to modulate E by itself, and that will modulate F. So we get like this scratchy type of tone. Now I'm going to pull it back so we don't get super scratchy tones, but one of the things that creates a bell tone is the ratio or the octave Okay, so as you go higher up, you get more metallic type of sound. So let's pull this up to like 32. And then you hear the metallic sound. My favorite verse VST is Expand 2, especially when you get it for 15. Yeah, it was $15 for one at one time. Now it's a lot more. Yeah, I'm telling you guys, just don't think that you need something outside of your laptop and headphones. It's just, what do you actually want? What inspires you? There's no need for anything outside of your laptop. Guaranteed. Plugins are probably the best investment you can make as a producer. Everything else is just, you know, unless you're recording 24/7, you don't need a bunch of stuff. I have a home studio, but I sit at the kitchen table on the laptop. There you go. All right, so what I need to do though is shape the envelope of E so that it's not long. I need to shape it so that's a short transient. Okay, so let's shape this with, and now the one thing about FM8 that I hate is the envelope controller. This is the worst interface for envelope. Okay, so now you hear that click sound. That's the beginning of a bell. Now the body of the bell is gonna be F, because that's the sound being modulated. So I still need to make F sound interesting. So let's control F with D, and D is gonna control F to modulate F. So this is a different reason why I'm modulating F, is to give it like a pitch wobble effect. So I'm gonna exaggerate it so I can hear what's happening. And then we're gonna lower what's called the ratio. We can divide this by 2 or 4. So let's do 0.25. And as you hear, it's slowing down. Or you could just set this to 0 and then have this offset at a specific frequency. So in this case, 60 Hertz. If you lower this, you hear a wobble. Okay, so if you listen closely, it goes woo, 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 like that. So this is kind of like having an LFO in Serum and it's giving you the Hertz values. So 5 is where you can audibly hear that vibrato. FL Studio or Pro Tools, what are you trying to do with it? Beats making, FL Studio. It's half impossible to make beats in Pro Tools. Like, it's so difficult. Pro Tools is great for recording, though, if you're an artist. So recording-wise, I'd say Pro Tools. FL Studio is good for beat makers. All right. So yeah, if you have a plugin question, just say the plugin and what your purpose is for it, and I'll tell you if it's worth it. But as far as the list of plugins, I have videos about that. It takes too much time to do research on that. Okay, so now we have the body of the bell. So we need to control how fast this vibrato comes in with an envelope. We want it to come in over time. So we're going to set what's called the attack time. Okay, so we need the sound to ring out. So we need to give it a release tail. Now, in this case, I'm going to use the body and the tail as the same thing. Okay, so F. We need to increase the release here. To where I hit a note and it's audibly long. Let me type this in, because okay, so I have it set to 3 seconds release tail. Do you know any free halftime alternatives? Yeah, it's called Deja Vu by Cymatics, even though I hate saying their company's name because they did us so dirty. But it is free, but it's a complete ripoff of halftime. It's so obvious they copied and took the idea from halftime. It's like the exact same plugin. Okay, so now let's modulate this. Now we need to give the bell like upper tones or overtones. So let's add another operator and give this different octaves. So firstly, I think the volume of the striking transient is a little loud, so let's pull that back. Now you're just gonna mess with these amounts until you get different tones. Okay, so one last thing, we're gonna pitch this up. Sounds a little weird in that octave. Okay, so from here, I would usually use effects. Let's go to the master, and we can turn on what's called, I haven't used this in a minute, the unison. Now, the transient could be better as far as like the sound of it. But again, I could have you guys here for decades. Let's try it. The body of the sound feels a little thin. All right, so what we could do is add another oscillator, operator, and have that be another output tone. So now it's thickening up the sound. I wish there was a quick way to, can you copy settings? Darn. I wish there was a fast way to just copy that envelope over to B. But we have to manually do it, which takes so much time. Okay, so now we can add this in at different ratios. We could add a fifth, which is half of an octave. We could do two octaves. And now we're just stacking overtones at this point. Now I can also have B go through what's called a saturator. Okay, so you have to route B to X. This is so much information. But you can route B to X to create upper harmonics and then X out. So X is going to be our saturator. And then you can turn up the type of saturation. Now in this case, let's drive it in. So you hear that buzzy sound? So that's the saturator. It doesn't really add much. Let's add some decay curvature here. I effed around and clicked something by accident. Oh my gosh, their envelopes suck. Goodness, man. That's a bell. In short, bells take a long time. So now you can stack them up to create unique sounds like this. Let's pull it down. Where's our volume? So e-pianos take a very long time to create. It's because you have to think about sounds in pieces. How can I hear notes on piano roll in FL Studio when I'm moving or arranging them? Can't seem to figure it out. Do you have an instrument loaded? Sometimes if you don't have an instrument loaded, it won't make sound. There's nothing to, you're triggering nothing. But you can left click. Here, I'll show you what I'm talking about. Like you can left click and just drag around in a normal sound. But if you're using what's called a sampler, which is the default sound that it gives you, there's nothing loaded. So you do the same thing and it makes no sound because there's no sound loaded. To load a sound, click the plus icon and click your plugin of choice. And it usually has a sound. All right, so what can we do to increase the, where's our pitch? Let's transpose this up. Two octaves. Now we're in that bell range. So that's bells in a very complicated explanation. Okay, so now that we have that sound, we need to go to our pattern one, do the same thing. And that is not the right sound. Oh. And that was long. Can't direct wave rip a whole sound off a plugin? Yeah, you can. You load up whatever the plugin is. So let's say it's Omnisphere, for example. You could do the same steps that I'm doing just with Omnisphere open, but there's a shortcut. I believe. So let's try it. Let's pick a random sample. Now their shortcut, I found it has some glitches in it. So I would do it the way I'm doing it, just with Omnisphere. But you could right click and create a direct wave instrument. Just right click, create a direct wave instrument, save it. I'm going to save it in an arbitrary folder. It's called delete. So I know how to delete it. And then copy these settings. Lowest note is going to be C3, which is pretty decent of an octave. B6 is going to be the highest, skipping every four notes. 127 max velocity layers. You only want one in this case. But if you want to get more unique, you can add velocity layers, so like four velocity layers, but that makes the size go up tremendously. So four is like a default, but to save space, you can put one. And then we're going to strip the silence. And what else is on here? And then turn all this stuff on. We don't need loop markers and all that. You can make a monolithic file, which means it's going to just make one file. You can just double click to load up. That includes the samples. If you don't want one file, but you want the sample separate, you can just turn off monolithic file, which it like for most people, it doesn't matter. Just click monolithic and then hit start. That's interesting. Maybe you, it's, that's not a default setting, so something might be turned off. FL, I don't think there's an option to turn off the previewing of sound, but I could be wrong. Let me see here. So I would assume it's under view. Or it could be in the project settings. I would Google that or ask Bard or ChatGPT, which is free, because that's such a specific. Oh, here it is. Preview notes during playback. Is that what's happening? Mine is turned off, though. I don't even know what that does. Preview notes during playback. I'm not sure what setting you have turned off, but I've never heard of that problem before. Let me just quickly skim mini panel roll views. Yeah, that sounds more like an Ableton issue, because Ableton has this like headphone icon that you have to turn on when you hear notes. But I've never had that issue in FL. But if anybody else had the issue, let them know. I would think it would be in the options somewhere, though, in the file, in the general setting somewhere, because it doesn't make sense that that would be turned off by default. I'm just quickly skimming. If I don't see it, I'm not going to like waste 20 minutes trying to figure it out. You're going to have to either Google that or hit the company up or ask ChatGPT, which would be the fastest. Yeah, I don't know where that would be. I don't know why you're not getting sound. It might be a plugin issue too. Who knows? So we don't really need to hive an octave. Go all the way back. I think that we need a lower octave. There we go. Okay, so now we have that. Purity is good. So I'm going to render this to audio. Consolidate track from track start. I'm going to turn off the master effects. Save loop markers. I forgot to show you the Omnisphere results. My bad. Forgot that fast. We're going to make this unique as a sample. Some reason that just kept going. I don't know what was happening there. Sorry about that. Yeah, I'm not trying to be rude. It's just, I've never heard of that happening before. Moneyline, check out Synth Master as well. Roland has a free VST. Really? I didn't know that Roland had a free VST. Yeah, Roland's definitely worth it, but I just wish the prices would be affordable instead of paying subscription every month. Okay, what was I doing? The Omnisphere thing. Okay, we need to check that folder. Delete folder and see if this will load up. So this should load up the synth that I had in Omnisphere. As you see, it loaded up the sound. So that's how you make your own thing out of existing. The only thing though, you don't have control over what are called loop points. When you do that, especially for sounds like this, because then the sound just dies out unless you sample enough seconds of the sound. You hear this weird click. There's like some weird artifacts that happen when you do it that way. But it's possible though to sample VSTs into direct wave like that. All right, so that's how it works. Hopefully that wasn't too broken of an explanation, because I forgot that we were doing that. Okay, so now let's do the bell. And I render. Yeah. Okay, so double click. We're going to right click, edit in audio editor, delete the loop, export this region as a sampler. Desktop, we're going to find our folder. So hopefully you are learning something here. Let's do one shot. It's going to call this a bell. Now, again, I would usually name these like something way cooler than just bell. Now we need to convert those one shots into a direct wave instrument. Let's open up direct wave. And then all we have to do is just drag and drop the samples we just created. Pretty simple. So that's how you turn your one shots into full on playable instruments inside of FL Studio. So hopefully we create a culture that has this built out for us instead of just one shots. Okay, so here's the stuff. Let's hear what it sounds like. Okay, so we need to liven the sound up. Let's add some delay and reverb. And people could always turn that off if they don't want it. Probably some settings. Okay, so now there's your plugin, basically. right? That's how you do it. Now we're gonna save that as, let's go in our folder. What up, Zane? Direct Wave, let's create a new folder called Bell. Usually, again, I would name this something more specific. Bell. All right, so that's how I'm creating these instruments for you. Again, the Sounds Vault will be available 2024, and it's gonna be one-time entry, not recurring, not production suites. Now, we're gonna have production suites in there, but it's not gonna be, you don't have to buy them every single time. I think that's overkill. All right, so next sound you guys told me. Now, is this answering you guys' questions? I don't want to sound so boring, but this is what I do behind the scenes. People want to see a vlog? Well, this is a vlog for you. You want to see what I do? I do this. This is what I do. All right, horns. Okay, horns are a little more interesting because horns, we could do it with Serum. Let's load up Serum. Now, a horn, to me, is more of a filter shape than it is. It's a lot of harmonics filtered. Okay, so let me show you what I'm talking about. Let's switch this to a basic sine wave. Let's edit the waveform. Actually, before we even get into editing, let's go to the filter, and I need to select an envelope over that filter. We're going to load up envelope 2 over the cutoff, and we want to make this not bipolar. So let's go to matrix, turn it on one directional. Give it a max value and a minimum value. Okay, so now we need to increase the attack time, make it pretty fast, and have a fast decay. So it's going to be like wow, like that. Let's lower the decay time. I'm going to switch out the waveform so we can hear what's happening. So that's what it's doing. It's creating a brassy. Just need to increase. So say somewhere around 60 milliseconds is a good attack time. DK could be faster. So we're just adding multiple voices as if we have multiple horns. The more you detune it, the more wide it sounds. And let's increase the max value. Now, also, usually with brass, you have what's called resonance. That's how you get that. That's how you get that type of tone. Now, I'm not going to use that wavetable. We're going to use a sine wave. So let's go back to the sine wave. And I need to create MIDI so I can hear what I'm doing as I'm doing it. Let's paste that in. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is add harmonics to this sine wave. So right now it's just playing MIDI. Let me turn this down a little bit. So right now it's just playing MIDI, but it's doesn't sound like anything because we don't have harmonics. How do you get success as an independent artist? You have to create an email list or text list. That's your only power as far as DIY type stuff. Anything else is a waste of time. You got to build up your email list and your text list. That's the answer. Now, I wish there was a fast way. Let me see something here. Oh, there we go. Wow, I didn't know you could do that. You could draw you could draw odd harmonics only. That saves so much time. You can right click and draw even harmonics. It's going to give you more of a sawtooth type sound. Snap vertical. Let's just generate a saw right now. Right now we have really low notes. We need to figure out why it's so low. Oh, I forgot we had like 18 voices. There we go. Another thing, you can use an envelope to move around your detune amount. So this is another kind of technique. We could take the detune amount to a high amount and lower to a lower amount in a very fast time. So I'll exaggerate. That adds more of a brassy tone too. Now, another thing I like to do in Serum is go to Notes on Alternative and modulate the panning of A. So every other note and make it left and right bipolar means. So now every other note triggers a panning. Makes it sound a lot bigger. Let's add also a vibrato to the sound. Let's drag this over the fine tune pitch. And lower this to about 3 hertz or so. Let's type it in, 3. 5 hertz would be a good vibrato. Let's add that delay. And let's... Okay, so now we need to give this a space, because right now it doesn't have like a space that's in. Let's give it some dimension here, aka reverb. So now it feels a little more real, and then compression will just even out the tones a little bit more. I still feel like that filter's not heavy enough, so let's switch out the filter. Like it needs something, so let's fill it up with some noise. Let's run this noise through the filter. I'm gonna use that vinyl noise just as a texture. You can't really hear it. Okay, so now it's a matter of the resonance amount. I know this is tedious, but this is sound design for you. Now we have a synthetic brass. Okay, so that's good enough. We could obsess, but I think we don't want to obsess too long. All right, we need to run this through the sampling method. So now we need to go back to pattern one and pull the octaves back, figure out the lowest octave we want. Now, in this case, the question is, do I continue the panning? And I think yes, because that will create a unique instrument. So let's right click, create consolidate from track, turn off master effects. Now we have that. So I'm trying to figure out why this renders all the way out. Let me do that one more time. I don't think I've cut remainder on. Okay, whoops. Cut remainder. Make sure you cut remainder, turn off master effects. All right, so now we have this. Let's double click. Right click, edit in audio editor. Now it'd be better if I made longer samples, because if you have longer samples, they'll overlap a little bit more interesting in other interesting ways, whatever the grammar is. Okay, let's go here, export regions for sampler use. We're gonna go to the desktop, find our sounds vault, find the one shots, create a folder called whatever your preset is. We're gonna call this brass. Okay, so now we're gonna open up Direct Wave. Hopefully you guys are starting to grasp the workflow here. We're going to open up Direct Wave, go to your folder, find your samples, left click and drag them into this mapping area. And then now you have an instrument you could play with the presets you just made. Where'd my MIDI go? Dang, here it is. Okay, let's pull this. Now, the one thing I should have done was sampled a lower octave, because this octave is way too high. So threw off the MIDI a little bit. That's why you want to have a universal octave so that everything fits, because you don't want to have people drag your MIDI down to C0 to get it to work. But here's the original tone. Let's add some reverb. So once you have the effects, you can also add, I believe, portamento in here, but we're not going to worry about that right now. Okay, so now we need to save this file, save as, and go back to our Direct Wave envelope. So we created, what, 4 instruments? Direct Wave. Let's create a folder called Brat, whatever your preset name is. Brass, in this case. Brass. Boom. So now, again, you always want to double check to make sure your stuff works. I know this is tedious, but like this is the work that you guys ask about all the time. Now let's right click, open up a new channel, and it should load up the plugin without any problem. You said how many hours you were putting, hold on, I can't read the whole message. How many hours were you putting in to work daily when you were nothing? When you were nothing? When I wasn't established, I would literally wake up, make videos for like, maybe like 10 videos. And then back then, I guess I had to do email support. So that would take another. So you could easily be going, 10 videos could take 4 hours. So that's 4 hours right there, just from videos, assuming that everything goes right. Because there's videos that don't work and you got to redo the video and then you got to do it again and it takes forever. So 4 hours on that. Then you have 2 to 4 hours of customer support. It just depends like how much customer support you have to do. So that's 8 hours right there just off of the basics. That's just to get stuff going. That's not including managing your marketing, figuring out ads, how to figure out how to grow. You know, there's a, you got to research just like anybody else. You got to learn. So you got to set aside time to learn. Learning is part of the job. So that could be 4 hours right there. So you're looking at 12-hour days minimum. That's minimum. You know, that's, it just comes with it. But the problem is most people can't commit 12 hours because they're doing something else. But the only way to see success is when you give 12 hours to something. So it's like, until people take that leap, they're not going to see a change. And I can't tell everybody to take a dramatic leap because it's dangerous. Don't do that. You have to have a plan. Here's our one sound we made. Here's our brass. I didn't think about the octaves would be panned to the left. I probably should redo that sample so it's not panned. Okay, and then we have the bell that we made. Some pretty decent sounds. I think the brass could be better. The bells are cool. The lead is pretty cool now that I'm listening back to it. And that flute is just too high pitched. I need to pitch it down. So then I'm taking notes on what can I do better. So that's the sound design. I actually do have to complete these melodic one shots and I have to do 10 of them. So once I'm done the 10, then we'll do like a quick Q&A or something to liven this up a little bit. But then I have to do melodic loops. Okay. So this is me working and you get to see how it looks. Okay. So now let's move a little bit quicker here. We have a synth that we have to make. So let's switch it up. Instead of using Serum all the time, let's use something different. Let's use... trying to look around to see all my plugins I have. I don't use a lot of stuff to sound design, so I'm trying to try something new here. Let me think. Let's do UHE Diva. People talk about it a lot. I don't think it's like the greatest thing in the world, but what I do is I'll go to presets, go to template, and load up one of these presets. So let's load up like a mini poly, for example. How do I load it? Then go to the main tab. Citrus is just, it's the same thing as FMA. It's just more complicated and harder to use, in my opinion. What is your best tip to a beginner producer? Just learn one thing. Learn one new concept every day. You have to force yourself to learn one new concept and study for 1 to 2 hours a day and then apply the technique you just learned. You'll learn faster in 30 days than you've ever learned anything, guaranteed. Okay, so let's load up Diva in this case. We're gonna create a synth sound. So synth to me is like something pretty big sounding, maybe a long a tail. Let's add some chorus. The output's pretty heavy. Turn it down. I don't like this interface, so let's switch it out for a different preset. Even this one's kind of weird looking. Let's do this. So basically these presets are switching out the interface here. So if you switch the panels, you can switch it out like this too, is a faster way. This looks more simple. Okay, so we have the sawtooth and we are going to pick an octave. Let's do low octave and then, actually let's do same octave and detune these from each other. And we need to turn oscillator 2 up. Is that the cutoff here? Now this sounds like a high pass, which it is, so let's not use that. And we could have envelope 2 control this filter, which is envelope 2 over here. So Now we're just telling the filter to go down over this amount of time. Plucks have a shorter decay time. Pull up the release. Pull up the attack here. The sustain. Let's add some coarsing to widen out. To me, it's a little thick of a sound, so let's make this the same octave. Output's kind of heavy, so let's pull that back. There's something in here. I forget which button, but it makes it like a higher quality. I forget where it's at. Okay, accuracy. Let's add some vibrato here. I mean, the sound isn't that exciting. Let's add some resonance at the peak. I mean, the sound isn't very... You know, with two oscillators, you can only do but so much, but even still. I mean, there's nothing really calling me to this plugin, so that's why I don't use it that much. But let's sample that. Okay, so do our thing here. Let's go here, pattern one. Double click. Move that into Diva. We're just gonna turn up the volume because I've noticed the volume on the last presets were a little low. Now for this one, we have to slow down the BPM because the tail of the sound lasts long. So we need to slow it down and make the notes shorter. Because the sound needs to die out before it gets to the next note. So what we could do in this case, let's just highlight everything. Hit Alt and then left click until they line back up with the octave. So now we're giving it enough space. But now you have to move the time markers. I have to sneeze. Give me a sec, guys. Okay, so now we need to move these time markers now that we're making this long sound so that they line up with the actual audio. So 0, 1, 2. That's why I give sound designers so much credit, because it just takes time. It just takes forever. Okay, so we're gonna right click, consolidate track from track start. Turn off any mastering effects. We're gonna cut the remainder and leave it in wave, blah, blah, blah. You said, I remember the only FL Studio tutorials were yours, and you lead the FL Studio movement. Image Line owes you a lot, bro. You would think that they would show respect, but they don't. They removed me as a power user, even though that alone is not like, it took them 3 years or 4 years to even do that. They removed me as a power user because one of their employees has something against me because he did me wrong, technically, on paper. His name is Josh from Image Line, and I introduced them to Beat Club folks, and the way I introduced them was just like, he just made it look like it wasn't professional. And I'm just like, what are you doing? Like, I forget what exactly happened, but so after that point, I'm pretty sure it was Josh or somebody who listened to Josh remove my power page off of FL. Now this is, I'm just saying facts. You know, as one of the early people who were making FL Studio tutorials, as one of the people who have gained, you know, a million followers specifically around one software more than the actual company, you know, as somebody who's, you know, shown people how to do it, and then those people taught other people how to do it. And then, like, it's not just me, it's how much influence we've created in such a short amount of time. And then the company won't even acknowledge me. That just showed me you can't trust anybody in business. You could literally make a company millions and millions and millions of dollars. They won't even acknowledge you. That's why I'm so not reliant on other people, because they could just switch up, do some weird stuff overnight. Crazy to me. Like, you would think a company like that would just, I think ultimately if they don't fix their culture issue at ImageLine, they're going to have a long battle downhill. Because if you can't even acknowledge one of the biggest names that helped your company for free, not even for free, but I'm saying you got a culture problem in that case. Okay, let's go here. Let's export. All right, let's go to, let's do here. Let's do one shots. And what do we make? Pad. Let's call it synth. But yeah, that's pretty crazy to me. Direct wave. That's like having beat battles every Monday, which we do. We're used to have them every Monday. And then me not even acknowledging our top beat battlers. Like, that would be insane. Is that some reverb? Delay? That's a pretty cool sound. All right, so let's save this as... I might take like a little Q&A break because this is getting monotonous. So whenever you feel like something's monotonous, sometimes you do have to step away from the task and then come back to it. Let's save this as direct wave. Let's call this synth. All right, always double check your stuff. So if you're sound designing or doing any stuff like this, you always want to double check to make sure it actually works. So right click, open that up. Okay, it works, great. All right, that's synth sound design. You guys want to keep going or is this boring? I don't even know how many people are watching. That's what's happening to Pro Tools, Native Instruments, and Waves right now. That's why we're seeing all these mergers and the reintroduction of perpetual licensing. Oh yeah, perpetual licensing. Oof, what a stab in the back. Nobody knew their products before you, I swear. It's pretty alarming, you know, that one employee's disgruntlement. It's not even one employee's, because they didn't acknowledge me for years. Like, I did so much behind it. The Razor Music campaign with Metro, Murder Beats, and all them. I was a part of that campaign with Dead Mouse. Let me see if it's still online. They probably redid the webpage. Razor Music. There might be records of it if you use Internet Archive, but they changed the website. It used to be called Razor Music. It's probably not up anymore. But there was a whole campaign. Here's one of the thumbnails. All right, so Razer Music. I was a part of this campaign to push these Razer laptops because the whole thing was Razer laptops included FL Studio. So Razer was selling laptops. FL Studio, you know, I don't know if they got a cut of the laptops or if they just got more exposure, whatever the deal was. But they got their software into the hands of however many people. And all the top influencers were pushing this laptop. That's why you see a lot of people with Razer laptops, Murder Beats, Metro, whoever at the time. And I was part of the campaign and I did it for more than anybody on the campaign. I did it longer than Metro. Not saying Metro is worse. It's just, I'm saying I did more business for that company long term. Longer than Murder Beats, longer than Sunny Digital, longer than Dead Mouse. I was on it for, I think, 2 to 3 years. Everybody else was on it for like a year. And my point is, the first time they came to me through FL Studio. So FL Studio, I guess Razer hit up FL Studio and then they made a deal. And then FL Studio came to me because they're like, crap, we have to talk to him because he's going to get us the numbers that we need, which is fine. That's part of the game. So it was a big enough project. It was a $1 billion company. I was like, cool, I'll do it because it's a $1 billion company. And I'm like, this is cool. It just felt exciting to be a part of something bigger than just a DAW. So we did that campaign. I over-delivered. I even spent my own money to make content that they did not reimburse. And, you know, just made the company look good, did campaigns and series around their software and their hardware. I don't even know how many laptops I sold because I didn't get the data and analytics. But, you know, my point is I did a huge favor for ImageLine, who did not pay me for that. Like, that was not from ImageLine. That was from Razer. Razer is the brand sponsorship, not ImageLine. Now, ImageLine, if they were doing good business, they would have had a check ready for all of the influencers. I wouldn't have to go to a Razer. So what happened is the first year they came to us. The second year I went to Razer and I said, here's what we did in the past. Here are the numbers we created. Here's all the influence we created. Here's how successful it was. And you guys saw how successful Razer laptops were because everybody wanted one. And so I went to them the second and third year, pitched them. I think I have the presentation. Let me see if I can find it. I usually only show this to premium people, but let me show you guys something. I don't know why I'm going on this tangent, but I might as well. Where'd I put that? Let me think where I would have that. I think it was a Google slide, if I'm not mistaken. Give me a second to log in real quick. All right, here it is. Razer, June 23rd, 2020. Here it is, Razer. Let me zoom in so y'all can see. Hold up, you can't see yet. All right. So Razer, X BusyWorks Beats, June 23rd, 2020. Here was my whole pitch to a billion-dollar company by myself, mind you, okay? I went to the company. Now, here's the other thing about Razer. Man, there's so much I forgot. When you build with big brands like this and sponsors, you're building with a person, and that representative represents the brand. The problem is when that person leaves the job to go somewhere else, you have to like reintroduce yourself to the company. Because I was doing business with Kevin. He moved over to Weed Maps, I think is the company name. So he moved over to Weed Maps, and then I was like, crap, I don't know anybody at Razer. Everybody had like a Chinese name. I'm like, who are these people? I don't know these people. So I had to reintroduce myself. And if I didn't have that past experience, you know, it would really have to be a hard sell because they don't know me and I haven't worked with them in the past. So all I'm saying is, here's the presentation. Let's see what I... Okay, so here's the presentation. Razer Music Producer Community presented by BusyWorks Beats. Now, I did this by myself. I just want to keep saying that. And I... You'll see in a second. Okay, who am I? Dang, I sound so stuffed up. I don't have any tissues either, darn it. All right, so bear with my dry throat. All right, who am I? Carlin BusyWorks Beats trained over 600,000... Now, okay, the reason I'm creating this is I want to show you guys what I do behind the scenes to help other content creators and producers. It's not just about me. It's how do I use my leverage of what I've done to get open the door for other people. And behind the scenes, it's hard to quantify that because, you know, all the confidentialities, but behind the scenes, I'm using my brand to help another content creator. And that's what I do behind the scenes. Is I usually am the first person to introduce these companies to the idea of even working with content creators. So let me read this real quick. All right. So it says trained over 600,000 producers around the world. Worked alongside Razer Music 2 years at this point. So this is my third, however many pitches later. ImageLine, FL Studio, Arteria. So all the brands that I work with. Universal Audio, Sweetwater, Billion Dollar Company, Akai, etc. And I said, imagine the new Made with Blade. I want to help you multiply your beautiful marketing campaign by adding fuel to your fire. Aligning with the top music producer influencers of the music producer community, I believe we can make an impact greater than sales. An impact full of culture shifting content and powerful engagement within the music producer community. So what is the key word? Aligning with the top music producer influencers. I didn't say only with BusyWorks Beats. And if you look closely, here's Simon Servita right here. And there's me. And there's, let me see who's Clip. And then we got somebody else notable here that I'm forgetting to mention here. But basically, that's us. Okay. I said influencers, right? So, okay, imagine a new Made with Blade with the key music producer influencers. Can you guys see the screen? I don't even know. Let me see. Where's my phone? I can't see the chat, so give me a second. I'm going to load up my phone to see if y'all can see what I see. Because if not, then that'll be a whole talking to myself here. Hold on. Let me find my own live stream. Get stupid ads. Okay, hold up. Okay, you do see the screen. All right. So it says, imagine the new Made with Blade. With the key music producer influencers, I believe we can syndicate your core Blade products across our content channels and email channels. I said content channels and email channels. So if you're a marketer, you know how powerful that is. And that's why you have power in this producer community is because you have actual distribution. Goes beyond the content creation channels to maximize your presence within the music producer community. I said, including, my head's in the way, I just realized, dang it, hold up. But basically it says, including any peripherals, they sell peripherals too, not just laptops, so it's headsets, microphones, lights, content creators, kits and different things you believe will fit the market. Help me get your products into the right hands so we can multiply your returns. That's what I said. here's the next slide. It says how we help you expand. Basically, I'm giving them a business model of how it works. I put the minimum, which is 2 million social reach at that time, which was a combination of myself, Simon. I don't even know all the people I had in that list at the time. Okay, so I said, now this is using my numbers, 500 plus thousand emails. That wasn't anybody else's numbers. That was my own numbers. Social reach is how many people, how many followers total, basically, can you reach? And that was, you know, a combination of a lot of folks. Huge records that we could use to push this blade, and then brand alignment too with other companies and different things. Then I said, we all send them to an aggregated website, a blog website made by Razor. All they would have to do is add a page where we add our content. We send everybody to that page. They sign up. They get interested in the blade, whatever. So we're sending all this traffic to one place from all of our efforts. And then I said, we're going to send syndicated emails and socials to follow up. And then you create what's called loving fans. That's what I said. And then I said, how we can help you expand. The Razor Blade 15, we will show how mobile and powerful this machine is for studio sessions and music workflows. I said, for the Razor Black Widow, basically, I'm showing how to promote each product. I said, we will show how important a great keyboard is to productivity with desktop-based producers. The Razer Mamba Elite, we will show how much easier it is to use a mouse with their laptop setups. And then lastly, the Razer Firefly was like a mouse pad that had lights. And I said, we will demonstrate how essential and inspirational Matt is when producing music. And then I said, why us? You know, and I explained why. Maximize market presence, hyper-focused traffic, which is true. Top-tier influencers, true. Save wasted production costs, true. Because we weren't asking upfront. We were looking on back-end deals. That was another part of this deal. Become the standard. Create loyal customers. Create dedicated culture. Ignite the spirit of gaming. And I showed my social proof of me working with Sweetwater, for example. Young Guru. Shout out to Young Guru. Breaking YouTube. Like, literally, a video went so viral that YouTube just showed like its maximum percentage and then didn't show us anything else. First 3 days and 23 hours compared to your typical performance. This video had 130,000 views in the first 3 days. Holy crap. I didn't know that. I forgot about that. Okay. And then I showed him my record on YouTube, you know, in this room, which was a Hollywood session. We had Bricks. We had, Nas Moore, who produced for Amigos and them. He's on Murder Gang's team. Or at the time he was. Go Grizz was in here. I don't know if my head's blocking it. Yeah, Diego Ave and Swish. So in that room, I think combined, they had 10 billion streams worth of music. Okay. And then I showed them I was on the panel of Universal Audio at NAMM. Here's the Razor Blade campaign. You guys can't see me, but I'm in the bottom corner. Let me move my head. Hold up a second. We're just doing a little history right now, a little intermission. So that's me in the bottom right, if you guys can see. Along with Metro Boomin, which I probably just blocked with my head just now. Noisia, Deadmau5. And Sunny Digital was a part of this. We had Anderson .Paak come in after us. Murder Beats after us. This is the CEO of Razer, a $5 billion company. Okay. At that time, worth $5 billion. This is Spectrasonic CEO, Eric Persing. And then I said, here's why they should pick us, basically. I said, no upfront production costs. We will create authentically, I can't read because something's in the way, to our audience and bring you the deepest connection with the community. Hyper-focused community, which is true. We have over 2 million followers who are all, we all are in the community together, basically. I said, light the community ablaze. The massive shift in the community will forever stamp your brand as number one in the field, which you saw the results of the Razer campaigns. That once they stopped pushing it, you saw what happened. Razer just kind of just disappeared. I've done this before, and I showed about my experience before. And then I said, no egos. It's all curated top influencers. And I said, my personal guarantee is, I said, I personal guarantee that my creator influencer friends, not just myself, and I, will present professional, high-quality, engaging content, which will shift the music production culture in your favor. If you are dissatisfied with any results, I would personally promote your brand to add to your goodwill. In other words, I will keep making content on their stuff. And then I showed my results. 100 plus million views, 800 years of influence as far as watch time, true leaders of the producer community. Okay, so that was my pitch to Razer, $1 billion company. And that pitch got us into the second and third year of that deal. So I forgot why I even went off on that tangent. who knows why I went off on that tangent. If anybody could tell me why I went off on that tangent, I will give you a handshake, virtual handshake. Oh, I said I was going to do Q&A. I forget where that spun off from. Let me read your comments real quick. Oh, you were talking about how ImageLine, I was one of the only ones doing FL Studio tutorials on that level at the time. And I said how ImageLine won't even acknowledge the people who built up their company. That's what I said. Then I went off into the Razer deal. And then I talked about how I pitched the company myself and pushed ImageLine without even, you know. So it's okay. You didn't ask me. Best plugins from FL Studio. I don't think FL comes with great stock plugins. I'm just being honest with y'all. Fruity Soft Clipper is probably the best one. Oh yeah, you got the holiday bundle. Shout out to Kazan. Thank you. Doing Massive sound design. I don't have the old Massive. I have the new one, and the new one is really complex. I'll use it though for maybe the pad sound design. I'll use it for the pad. There's definitely a culture problem, and we won't see it until probably 5 years from now, but there's a huge culture problem at ImageLine right now, behind the scenes too. Like, the top guy who's in charge of artist relations should not be turning off top influencers, because if you turn off the top influencers, there goes your whole business plan. And I warned them about that, but they didn't listen. We'll see. Anybody else that wants more advice, please join the Discord. Dope. Everyone, can you please hit the like button? Dang, Paleface is putting in work. Thank you. It's a soldier right there. Trust me, they know who you are, or knew who you are. But it's just like what they have done to the sudden death of the main software developer who created FL. The sudden death. Did he die? Trust me, they knew who you are. But it's just like what they have done to the sudden death of the main. Did he pass away? I didn't know that. Yeah, Weed Maps, that's funny. Due to all the this is when Weed Maps was first coming out too. He left the company at Razer to go work at Weed Maps. Due to all my respect to Servita, but his paid tutorials are not up to my expectations. Gotta get y'all refund. You gotta hit him up for a refund. I don't know what his program's called. I forget what it's called. Let me Google. Let's see what his program's called. I mean, shout out to Simon Servita. If anything, you should buy it as a thank you to say, oh, it's called Pro Level Beats. Okay. But even if you didn't get much from it, you should be like, here's my thank you, because he's already created so much entertainment and value already. So it's not like, what else can I get? Sometimes it's just like, even if it wasn't what I expected, that's my thank you to that person. Like, do I need producer-made drum kits? No, but I buy them because I'm like, I want to support the producer. Pro Level Beats, it says, attention producers, watch this video to learn how easy it is to create an endless supply of new melodies, chord progressions, and pro-level beats. I've never taken this course, so I don't know. But it says 8.5 hours of training, 3,800 students, and almost 5-star rating. Let's see what his commercial says.
Hi, my name is Simon Servita, and this is my course, Pro-Level Beats.
How do you make this bigger?
So I've been making beats for over 10 years now. I started making music around the age of 14. And during that time, I really wasn't into music theory. I ended up taking music a lot more seriously when I went into university. And believe it or not, the first time I took that music theory class, I failed that. It was really overwhelming. So obviously I had to learn it within a semester of time. The concepts were really hard to grasp.
I know, sheet music sucks.
I thought that the content wasn't relevant to modern music. Right here. When's the last time you heard of a Neapolitan 6 chord in a Billboard song? We go
up to the... Exactly. Like, music theory is cool, but I think they overcomplicate it a lot.
That's kind of cool. The best part about this course is that I designed it for the modern producer. So this course is a culmination of the music theory I learned in university, as well as 10 years of
experience. Like, if anything, to take from the course, even if you say you don't learn, like, technique, you need to learn how to be a Simon Servita. Like, he's a salesman, he's a content creator, he knows the craft, he could sing, he could pitch for whatever. Like, you need to study how people on this level move, because if you're trying to up level yourself, you got to like really model people who are doing it in the new world, which is this digital content creator world. The old industry world is very archaic in a lot of ways. And you'll see that the only ones who truly stand out are the ones who create a brand. Simon Servita has a brand, and you need to figure out what, you don't need to copy what he does, but you need to figure out what is making his brand so strong. Even if you don't take the music theory techniques away or whatever it is that he's saying.
making beats. The course is over 8 hours long across over 50 videos, and the website is designed so that learning music theory is as streamlined as possible.
Like, look at the editing of this video alone.
This knowledge is applicable to all aspects of music. Beat making, producing, studio sessions,
multiple
with artists,
angles.
It doesn't matter if you use FL Studio or Ableton or Logic, it works.
Now here's a color psychology thing. I'm not saying he did this on purpose, but red is actually a color about action. So if you knew that red triggers people to take action, you wouldn't, you know, for those who are unaware of that, that would go right by you. But red actually promotes action takers, specifically fire signs like an Aries. So if you didn't know that, you would never. Now, I'm not saying he did that on purpose, but that's what I mean by you got to study what people are doing.
Works in any DAW. Let's quickly go over what you're going to see in the course.
All right, so he maps out the course. It says learn the language. I guess he means of beat making. Basic melodies, drums, and chords. Advanced melodies, counter melodies, and chord progressions. Basic drums, 808s, and bass lines. Advanced composition. Advanced bass. And then what? Oh, I clicked the wrong button. Hold up. Darn it, y'all. My fault. And then it says game break, or excuse me, genre breakdowns. Has anybody in the chat taken Simon Cervita's course?
Split up into 9 different modules. So level 1 is learning the language. So this is for people who are starting from complete zero and have no knowledge when it comes to music theory. So if you're someone who's completely new to this world, I got you covered. From modules 2 to 4, we get into our basic beat making. In this section, we go over
So now he's just showing you the breakdown. Okay, basic scales, basic chords, intermediate level ear training, basic rhythms and drums. So even if you were skeptical of his course, you could go on Google and say, hey, what's the basic scales? What are the basic chords? What's intermediate level ear training? What's basic rhythms and drums? And if you feel like you can educate yourself off of Google, then do it, you know, including my own materials at busyworksbeats.com. The difference is that we're training it from a perspective that says what not to pay attention to. Like, a lot of people think they need to pay attention to everything when they're starting. And if you pay attention to everything, you could be working really hard going in the wrong direction. But you need to learn what not to pay attention to. That's just as important as what to learn is what not to learn. And yeah, so again, we teach in our own unique ways too. So I'm sure it's not just cookie cutter. Hey, here's a minor scale. Here's a major scale. Here's the whole half whole. You know, it's deeper than that. So on surface, you can get a lot of information, but there's still experience that I feel like Simon can offer, myself can offer.
Fundamentals. We talk about beginner concepts like intervals and chords and scales. These are things that you need to know so that you can build upon it later. This section.
Now, my music theory teachings are different because I'm teaching you from a chord codes perspective, which is very different from scale degrees. I do teach traditional scale degrees, but I think it confuses people more than it helps. Okay, so why am I here? I forgot why I even got the Simon Cervita's page. Somebody was saying about his course. So this is a long sales page. You know, I'll give you guys the gist. And whenever a sales page, you have to scroll like 20 times to get to the bottom. Like, it's not always a good thing. Like, it's going to be, and I'm not critiquing Simon. That goes for my own website. Let's go to busyworksbeats.com/premium. Now you can get started for free. It's another USP of my business is I let people start for free. And if they truly are learning something and they're truly motivated to continue, then they could pay the next payment. But only until they try it for free. So I have 60 plus music production courses. Now let's see how long it takes to scroll on my sales page. You have the top page, you have testimonials, you have sections of what's included. Mainly a lot of pictures going on, a lot of what's inside. So even my page takes a while to scroll down. It could be shorter. Okay. But anytime the sales page is like super, 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 super long and it just goes on and on and on and on and on, that's a chance, you know, chances are they're trying to make, it's like putting a ton of makeup on. Like if somebody puts a ton of makeup on, like where they're just, I'm not judging people's look or anything, but you know, then that means the product probably isn't the greatest. If there's so much like stuff going on in their sales page. Okay. Cause that's our version of like marketing makeup, so to speak. All right. So, you know, I don't know how many scrolls it takes. Let me see. Let me count. See how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 hard scrolls. Let's see how long it takes to get through mine. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 4.5. So, you know. But yeah, so does he have a refund policy? Let's see. I don't see anything about refunds on this page. Do I have a refund policy? Let's see. is my thing working? I'm pretty sure I say something about a money back guarantee. Maybe I called it guarantee. Did I forget my money back guarantee? It should say, oh, cancel it anytime. There it is. All right, so that's my money back guarantee. I don't see the word refund on this page. Is there a guarantee? He said, with some of my favorite advanced chords and scales, guaranteeing you never get stuck on B block again. 30-day money back guarantee. So if you didn't make, let's read his guarantee though. It's a little long. This gives you a full month to try out the program, go through the first levels, apply what you learn. And if you don't hear a tangible difference in your music, if you don't have a newfound confidence and excitement every time you open your DAW, it says, heck, if you don't have friends and fans immediately noticing the difference in your music after you go through this training, I'll send you 100%. Hold on, I got ads on my YouTube, my fault. It says, basically, if you don't get the results, he'll send you 100% of your money back. No questions asked, no hoops to jump through. Just make an honest attempt at following this 9-level program. And he says, I will literally guarantee you make better music and have a lot of fun. So you as a customer have to ask, did you truly apply what he's teaching? Or did you just get bored and just not try it? So that's part of his guarantee is if you do try it, then you get the money back guarantee. Mine is if you just want your money back, you just, for whatever reason, I'm not here to hoard your money. I just rather people who actually want the program than people who just don't want it. But yeah, that I don't know why we went on a deep dive, but that's Simon Servetus' thing. Hold on, I'm trying to switch screens. Hold up. Thanks for the free holiday. Thank you. We're going to get back to sound design in a second. I'm just reading your chats. Skidda, da da da. Okay. Trying to catch up to where I was. Do it all the respect. Okay. Can anybody... Is this about indie music marketing? Oh, sorry, Hat Smith. I was just going on a tangent about small things. This live stream is about sound design. This is not about anything else. I mean... You got to talk to people every now and again. You can't just bore people to death with techniques. It's about ImageLine, the creator of FL. Wow, it's the video. Okay, I'm trying to read through. Game saying he was removed as an FL power user. Oh, yeah, I was telling a story earlier about how ImageLine doesn't even respect their own people pushing their own products to millions of people. Like, that's insane to me. I think they have a culture problem for sure. Insane to me. Yeah, I was on their little power page or whatever it's called. And first of all, let me say something. This is just my stream to just have a stream of consciousness, as you guys can see. Let's load up the ImageLine. I'm just going to expose this little power user list because this, first of all, it's not because I'm mad I'm not on it. It's just, it's hilarious who's on this actual list. All right, let's switch screens real quick. So, firstly, there's a lot of people on this list that nobody knows. Like, let's start there. And that's because they're not in the culture to know who's actually in the producer community. So they read about a DJ and they're like, oh, this DJ used FL for one time. And now we're going to add him to the thing. Okay, Martin Garrix. Shout out to Martin Garrix. Murder Beats. Shout out to Murder Beats. Now, you guys saw with the launch of ImageLine Sounds, they tried to use Murder Beats as like their holy magic pill to get it working. Be honest in this chat. Does anybody in here use the FL Studio Sounds? Let's take a quick poll. Can I create a poll from my phone? Let's take a quick poll real quick. Who here? This is no shade to FL. I just want to know. Hold on. I got so many attachments on my thing. Give me a second. All right. Let's take a poll real quick. Who uses FL Studio Sounds subscription? It's like their version of Splice in FL Studio. Let's take a real poll real quick. You could be honest. It's an anonymous poll, so you won't be outed. Simon is on FL Studio Mobile. Is he? Instead of just asking them for a lot of money for little value, what's that mean? What are you referring to? Any basic or hack kind of value of gain stage? Gain staging is more for recording. It's not for like making beats. I think people overthink gain staging. It's just, in beat making, it's more so if you add an EQ and you boost 6 dB, if you're clipping from that point into the compressor, you're going to get a different sound than if you just lowered the output of the first EQ into the compressor. So that's our version of gain staging. if you're talking about leveling, which is turning the faders up and down, leveling, I mean, if you're recording, negative 18 is a good spot. It's like the universal VU meter zero, but man, it's like I got something in my nose stuck. Hold up, y'all. Let me just clear my throat. I don't even know if I cleared my throat just now, but whatever. Okay. I do Flex and the new Kepler. I don't use Kepler. Huh? It seems kind of strange that they released that one. The problem is these companies started as part of the community. Let me read it word for word. Mars says, the problem is these companies started as a part of the music community, then sold out to larger companies and introduced greed. Now people are leaving them for companies that treat them better. True. If another dog could come up with the FL Studio workflow, it would be a quick race to the bottom as far as their culture goes, FL's culture. Are there any basic... Okay, I think I covered that. You said, I think FL plugins are dope though, game. You just have to color and edit. It's too... I think from my experience, DJ Michi, is that you have to do way too much to an FL Studio sound to make it sound good. Logic, you load up a sound, it sounds perfect. You don't have to do anything to it. I think once they figure out the sound design part of their DAW, it'll be a lot better. They're working on it, but it could be a lot better. Okay. 75% of you said, no, you don't use the FL Studio sounds. Now, you guys saw when they launched FL Studio Sounds, the subscription, they tried to use Murder Beats as like the front man to get everybody interested in FL Studio Sounds. And it still didn't work. It's because the Murder Beats is used almost like Snoop Dogg. And shout out to Murder Beats, like, get your bags. I'm not talking about him. I'm talking about the concept of what these companies, let's replace the word Murder Beats for Snoop Dogg. They think they could hire a Snoop Dogg and get everybody to buy into an idea. But the difference about the online producer community is that you have to go to the people who are respected by the online producer community in terms of making beats, in terms of knowledge and education, in terms of goodwill within the market. Murder Beats is an aspirational character. People want to be Murder Beats. We all grab that. You know, he has all the accolades and he has the reputation and he has the PR to go with that. He has the good image. The problem is, though, people think that translates into this online space. And sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. You guys saw Timbaland come over and he figured out the online thing to where he could make that work. You guys saw, I mean, you can name an artist or producer who tried to hop in the music producer community and it just flopped because it's not based on celebrity. It's not based on Grammys. It's not based on plaques. That's not what gets people to invest. You have to create goodwill within the people by educating them, showing them something. Jay Cactus was also a part of that. Now, I was also left out of that conversation, the FL Studio Sounds conversation. I found that hilarious considering, you know, again, but like I said, it's up to that company what they want to do, whether they like me or not, made their company millions of dollars and that's a fact. Okay, Martin Garrix, Murder Beats, Afrojack. So I'm going to go through this power list real quick and just point out people who like should not be on this list. And no shade. Okay, Larrickson, was my comment deleted? Showing up now. It might have been a keyword that got deleted. So Boy One is on the list. Porter Robinson. There's a lot of people I don't know, so I'm going to, you know, I don't know everybody. Mustard, Madiant, Tay Keith, Avicii, RIP. Did he pass? Yeah, Avicii. Plus, Deadmau5, Sunny Digital. Okay, TM88. Okay, so I'm going to move through these folks. They even tried to put the blackface of Ninth Wonder that they ignored for years and years and years and years when Ninth Wonder was one of the first people to make FL Studio popular to the hip hop community. So it just shows like how detached they are from the culture. T Minus is on here. I'm going to skip through here. Jahlil Beats. There's somebody. Let me keep scrolling. Now, Diego Ave, shout out to Diego. He uses FL for his, I think, compressor and his drums. I saw him using Ableton in the studio, but maybe he uses FL now. I don't know. Who else? No shade to Diego. I'm just saying like facts right now. Wonder Girl. Who else? Young Keo. There's people on this list, is my point, that use Ableton and they use FL for like one time. And because they have accolades and they have plaques, that FL's like, oh, let's use your image to make it look like you actually use FL. And that hollowness is the reason why FL is going to eventually collapse if they don't get the culture right. Because they're picking the surface level stuff. They're not picking people who actually have the goodwill in the actual producer community. Like, I don't even think Larry O's on here. Or is he? Let me see. Oh, okay, he is on here. Okay, let's say if Jay Cactus is on here. Jay Cactus isn't even on their power user list. Like, come on. Produced by Jack, is he on here? Nope. Terrible. Okay, who else is from the FL community? Chucky, is he on here? Yes. Okay. Who else? FL. Who else has the FL got? Nick Mira. If Nick Mira's not on here, like, come on, y'all. Y'all don't even have the basic people who built up FL on your power list. That alone is the reason why their culture is going to fall. Craziness, right? I don't know why I'm telling so many stories, but this is the side that you guys don't get to see. I guess this is the day in the life of a business person. Now you get to see all this behind the scenes stuff. We're going to get to sound design in a second. Just wanted to answer your questions. Was Simon Servito on there? I didn't check. Probably. Let me see, actually. I'm curious. Hold up. FL Studio Power Users. But two, we can say that the company doesn't keep up with this page, but I know they do because they deleted my page. So they definitely keep up with it. Okay. Simon Servito is on that list. Okay, good. I see and agree. I use third-party effects to make sounds super dope like RC20. What has a plug or link for Logic Pro? I read that wrong. Who has a plug? Just grab it. Save up your money. You'll enjoy it more when you buy it. People enjoy the struggle. That's where happiness comes from, is the struggle. If you don't struggle, you're not going to be happy because it's too easy. Who I think does make sense? Was my comment deleted? No. 90% of those power users are not into the game anymore. They moved on. Wonder Girl should be at the top of that list. You know what I mean? Like, there's certain, it's just a culture problem. I don't have time to go into it. Who would you put on this? I just wanted to ask, what aspect of beat making should I approach when I start producing? I think music theory is your greatest lever. Then you want to learn it. Beat making. Then you want to actually, before you even learn music theory, learn your DAW first. I have a free FL Studio course. If you go to our website, it's busyworksbeats.com/premium. It's completely free. It's called the FL Studio 21 Beginner's Guide or something like that. Get that course because you have to learn how to move around before you learn how to apply stuff. We're going to get to sound design in like 3 seconds. D-Dot Will needs to be up there. It's one of the game. All them got a free key. True, probably. This is a list of people they want that we sent keys to. That's hilarious. It's everywhere game with no blacks in office positions. Oh, don't even get me started on blacks represented in these audio companies. I went to Isotope's headquarters in 2018. I looked around. I did not see anybody that looked like us in that entire facility, let alone black. I don't even know if they have black people in there. I don't know. They might have, but I didn't see any from what I remember. And I didn't see anybody that even remotely looked like a music producer. Not a one. And this is a company with multi-Emmys, multi-millions of dollars to pay staff. They had like 200 employees in their headquarters. Not a one that looked like the music producer community. And their head of social media moved over to, I want to say, Avid. And I'm like, they don't look like us either. Not saying that it's wrong. I'm just saying, like, they don't have anybody that even... All I'm saying is these audio companies, you know, behind the scenes, if I could just show you and give you a brain dump, you guys would have a whole different perspective about them. Ableton. All right, let's get back into sound design. You're doing an awesome job. Okay, so I just wanted to have a little brief intermission. Now let's get back to the grind. So for those who hopped in late, this is basically looking over my shoulder into what I do every single day. Since you asked for a vlog, here's your vlog. But it's not as exciting as you may expect. So this is sound designing right now. Now we're going to sound design a guitar, but I'm going to use Logic Pro because they have a much better process of doing this. So I'm going to open up Logic Pro real quick. Save this. So for guitar sound design, we're going to use Logic Pro. Let's see if we could do something with pads and then keys. We're going to also try Logic Pro. So this benefits to each DAW. I'm going to show you guys in a second. Lex Luger definitely put on for FL's hip hop community. Roderick is here. What up? All right. So I'm going to show you guys some really advanced sound design. I already showed you how to take one shot to make complete plugins out of it, basically. So now we're going to move into sound design. All right. Logic Pro is scanning plugins right now, so give it a second. All right. So as that loads up, we might as well do the pads since it's loading up. Pads are... Let me make sure you guys can see the screen. Okay. So when it comes to sound designing pads, there's no one thing about it. It's just your understanding of how to achieve that pad sound. Pads usually have a slower attack. They usually have a longer release. That alone could be a pad. But how you shape the pad becomes complex. You could use subtractive EQ, like a filter, to shave off the high end. Why it sounds so low. You could have this filter move, you could have resonance, you know, there's a billion and one things. Pads usually move really slow. So let's slow it down to like a bar level. Okay, let's thicken it up with multiple voices. Even this is a little. All right, sorry, this Logic is loading up false plugins there, okay. So I'm about to show you guys how to create a guitar sound in Logic if it loads up. It's taking a little bit. Okay, so even the sound is pretty bright, so let's pull this back. And also pads mess with the resonance a lot. My goodness, all these screens. Hold up, y'all. Getting all these pop-ups. Let's do a basic pad. Let's not make it complex. All right, let's do a multi-voice saw. To detune it with a long attack. We're talking seconds of an attack. That's the majority of the sound. I know it's boring, but then you add your filters. Let's do a 24 dB proactive filter. You could add the same envelope over top of your cutoff filter so that your cutoff follows your envelope so that it feels like it's both building up an attack and harmonics. That will keep it a little more uniform. And then when you let go of the key, so does the filter. Now, what most people don't show you is how to create, I'll call this like additive synthesis. You can start with a sine wave. Then we're gonna have another sine wave modulate the sine wave. So this is where you get into more like PlayStation type pad sounds. So we're gonna go from oscillator B, go to FM from B, and then turn up your amount here. And that's how you get that type of sound. Okay, now to make this a little more exotic sounding, let's do notes on alternative. Select oscillator A panning, make it bipolar. So now multiple notes will be panned to each side. It just sounds more interesting to the ear. And now let's add what's called a vibrato to the fine tune pitch. Let's pull in the range here. Let's pull the hertz value to about 3 or 5. If you want that slow, like weekend sound, pull the range up and then slow down the rate. I forgot that let's remove that actually. Let's put this over top of the fine pitch of oscillator B because that's controlling the pitch of A. That's how you get that 80s vibe. So you probably never heard sound feel that analog in Serum, and that's because a lot of people don't know about the alternative pitch. So Logic is still loading up plugins, so give that some time here. And then you can add your reverbs and your delays and your choruses and all that. I don't think we need chorus. It's already chorused. Let's add some more reverb. Now, for more advanced pads, you can have LFOs control stuff over time. For this video, that's like arbitrary and it's boring. Okay, so let's just sample this pad. Now, to sample a pad, you would need really long notes because as you saw, it takes time for that pad to actually trigger. So these notes are too short to trigger that entire pad sequence. So to sample this, you're gonna have to draw in really long notes. or slow down your BPM. So let's sample this. Let's right click, consolidate. Now, also before I do all this, let's turn up the volume so that we don't have to keep cranking it up in post. All right, so now let's right click, consolidate from track start, turn off master effects, cut remainder, and then boop. All right, so you can see visually what the pad looks like. So it looks like it clipped a little bit. So that bitey noise, is it clipping? Now we did, I think, 16 bits. So we can't undo that, but whatevs. What we're going to do, though, is I think Logic is about to load up. Give me a sec. Right click, go to edit in audio editor. And now we are going to click up here, go to export regions for sampler use. Go back to your desktop folder. Where we at Sounds Vault, find our one shots folder, type in pad, call this pad. Okay, so now we have the samples and we need to load up Direct Wave. You've seen this so many times and I'm like, dang. Okay, so Direct Wave, and then open up your folder for your pad, highlight all your samples, just drag it into the key mapping area here. And then now you have your mapped out pad into Direct Wave that you could play like an instrument. And you can share that with other people. So let's add, we don't need reverb, we don't need delay, we don't need anything. I forgot about that alternative panning creates a whole octave of notes pan to one side. Keep forgetting about that. So let's do this. Usually I would sample every four notes. Gives you more variety. So here's what the pad sounds like. That distortion kind of screwed up the sound. We'll have to redo that. Plus, I have to take off the panning for that one. Okay, so that's neither here nor there. Or I could do octaves. I'll decide what I want to do. That one needs to be redone because it clipped. I had the volume up too loud. That's why clipping is bad. Okay, if you needed an example. What is this? Incompatible, whatever. Okay, Logic Pro is open, so let's create this guitar. So I showed you how to create a pad. I'm going to go back and redo the pad. I just don't want to waste time on this live. Now let's sound design a guitar. Come on, Logic. Check, check, check. You guys should be able to hear me now. Let me double check. All right, yeah, okay. All right, sounds good. Okay, so now we have that. The way we're going to, oh yeah, thank you for letting me know. We're going to sound design a guitar is we're going to load up a new software instrument in Logic. And we're going to load up the instrument called, I want to say it's called the Sculptor. So this models different instruments and there's different presets. So you can get started with different presets. You can model pads, you can model guitars, keyboards. Where's guitar? I swear they had guitar in here. Hold on. Modeled. Give me a second to figure out what guitar would be under. Oh, plucked instruments. We could do nylon guitar. Hit Command K. Now you have your guitar. Okay, so if you wanted to perform this, you could add some MIDI effects here. Go to your, what's it called, your modifier. We're gonna select the input as the pitch bend, reassign it to the pitch bend, and then make this 20% instead of 200. So now when you do pitch bends, it'll be not as dramatic. So now I can practice on that. Sounds more realistic of a pitch bend. Okay, so that's how you create the guitars. Now the interface isn't the easiest to understand with the Sculptor plugin. It's basically like Sakura, but on steroids, basically. This thing is like 5 Sakuras in one. So this is a much better done string emulator, I don't know, resonator, whatever you want to call it. So there's different, you know, the interface is not the easiest. That's the only problem with this. Logic's interfaces are not great at all. So it's very hard to even like know what button does what. So in this case, I'd suggest just moving stuff around until it works. Not the greatest advice, but... you can switch the materials in the middle here. It might be a little bit easier. So that was your pluck sound. And then you would do the same sample thing. You would just put in the octaves in your MIDI. Create a MIDI region, create a MIDI region. You would do the same exact thing. Let's hit control. Whoops. Hit control. We're going to add these notes in. So you pick your lowest note, play the note. Okay, you can copy this. Control. Oops, hit all the wrong buttons. Control R. Hit Shift Alt to pull it up to the next octave. Highlight these. Control R. Command R, I should say. Alt shift, pull that up. So now you have the octave, same thing as FL, it's just not as easily shown. And then now you can sample that. Mute these. So I would do 1, 2, I think we did 6 octaves. Let's copy these, command R. Okay, then we're gonna highlight everything, pull it down. So now we have all the octaves. Okay, so now you need to print this to audio. I think you can go to file. We have a Logic course on our premium. I don't use Logic every day, but I show you how I use my workflow. So let's go to export, and then you can do one track as audio file. Then we're gonna select the nylon track. Track name, blah, blah, blah. Let me save it to my desktop just to make sure this is working the way I think. Let's go to the delete folder. All right, I don't know why I did like 1,000 bars. We only had a couple highlighted. So it soloed the sound that I was on. Okay, so let's just double check, make sure it did it right. Let's go to our desktop. And it did not do anything I expected it to do. Where's our sounds? It did not do what I thought it was going to do. What is this? What is it? That is a whole different track. All right, so that's the wrong track. Let me figure out a way to export just this track. Right click. I usually export the entire song, so this is a different process. Let's go to file. The thing is, I wanted to select this track. It didn't let me select it. Select is on here. Let's just do selection as audio file, whatever. I printed the wrong track. But how do you select your track? All right, I don't know what else. You say use the top highlight, like right here. It's giving me random files. What is this one? Okay, so call it a Rihanna Hip Hop. It's basically all those things that we just did. It's not the greatest way to do it. I never did this in Logic specifically, so my workflow is a little off as far as rendering one track at a time, but that's basically the file. I would call this guitar C0 to whatever C6, whatever it was. Okay, and then I would render those out and then load them up into Edison and slice it, export the multi samples. So that would be the workflow. I'm going to save you guys boring time. Okay, so the last thing here is keys. So in this case, you could just go to your presets and they model different pianos. I don't know how the sound designers use this interface. This interface is not easy to read. I didn't realize YouTube put so many ads on my thing. It puts an ad on here like every 10 minutes. All right. So anyway, that's how I would start. And then since the thing is so complicated to read, I would just kind of move stuff until I hear a tone change for this plugin because it's so not easy to read that, you know, I would just move stuff until it works. Okay, you can even switch out the sound, the starting sound, transient sound. Oh, ad blockers. They block the actual live stream ads. I thought that was for static ads. Okay, so that's how you would do the keyboard. It's kind of was anticlimactic, but that's how I would do it. Steve Jobs would be proud. Shout out to Steve Jobs. All right, so that is that. I'm going to wrap up this live stream only because I really have to sound design and I have a lot to do. Actually, I said I was going to do melodic. How long have we been live streaming? Let me see. 2 hours. So I'm going to actually get focused on the sound design. But the next thing I'm going to do for the Sounds Vault, if you weren't here earlier, I'm creating a new Sounds Vault at busyworksbeats.com. So it's going to be all my sound packs in one thing. One price, access to everything. I'm not going to be doing the suite production suite beta. Production suite. Get the, you know, the secret USB to have, it's just too much. So we're just going to have one big vault, one price, and you're going to get all the updates and all that type of stuff. They're good upstairs. I just want to say this. You bring a lot of value to the community, bro. If no one else tells you after this, I want to tell you thank you. Sean Mays. Clap it up for Sean Mays. I would show you guys the melodic loops stuff, but it's just, I don't want to overexpose these live streams to where it becomes so boring that I don't want to do them. Okay, so we got to kind of spread it out a little bit. Okay, so what I'm going to be doing so far, I have, and if you, let me see, I got to load up FL. It might switch my sample rate, so give me a second, y'all. If you hear any clicks, it's my sample rate. All right, so as you hear, it sounds robotic because I am two different sample rates, so I need to switch, hold on. All right, so technically, all right, it's still glitchy. So what we have to do is reset, make sure this is 44, make sure that my UA audio interface is at 44, because sometimes it doesn't switch. All right, it's at 44. Okay, but it doesn't mean the audio is coming through here. So you got to always double check. Check, 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 check. It should be good to go. All right, so that was a surprisingly easy switch. Usually when I go from 48 to 44, it like blows up my computer. Check, check, check. You should hear me now. Sorry about that. Check, check. I was literally talking to my... Check, 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 check. Okay. My fault, y'all. Y'all were not hearing me. I was basically saying how the sound vault... My live stream is a little delayed, so give me a sec.
Check, check, check. Check. You should hear me now.
All right. What was I saying? Okay, so I was basically saying how, let me say this all over again, how the sounds vault that I'm building is going to be one price, access to everything for an entire year plus. And I haven't determined an exact amount of time, but we'll just say a year access. What was I going to say, though? And it's not going to be like all these other production suites where it's like production suite beta, the full production suite, you know, the secret hidden USB that gives you extra sounds. It's going to be all whatever I create and whatever we add to this entire vault. And you'll have access for the entire year. It's going to be one price. We're not going to be doing all the upsell nonsense. It's just straight sounds and whatever we create in one big vault called the Sounds Vault. Okay. So here are the 808s. I was basically saying how I was making drums the other day. This is my favorite 808. All right, 808s are cool. Kicks hit harder, in my opinion. But the hi-hats are pretty dope. And I sound designed all these from scratch. This is not refurbished sounds. These are sound designed from scratch. As you saw how deep we went to sound design earlier. And if you want to learn sound design, how to make your own drum kits, I have an entire course on sound designing a drum kit specifically. You can get learning for free. Just go to busyworksbeats.com/premium. You get a 14-day free trial. So the kick hit super hard. Kick G and H hit very hard. Then you have one shots, which I just showed you how to build today. The one shots, multi-track one shots. So it's more than just one sample. And I even gave you guys the direct wave instruments for that. So you could load up, you know, what the synth, for example, and play multiple notes. Okay, you can play it right in there. So it's going to have direct wave instruments, 808s, hi-hats, kicks, one shot. It's going to have melodic loops, snares, drum loops, presets, templates, all types of stuff. So it's going to be a very big thing. I'm going to have it ready by the new year. So that's what's taking up my time right now. But as you guys can see, sound design comes down to time more than skill. It just takes a lot of time. Snares, claps. So I sound designed those from scratch. All right, so that's where I'm at with the pack right now. It'll grow once we add the melodic loops and all that other stuff. All right, I will catch up with y'all when I can. Yeah, it's a couple stories in there, through in there, but